The University of the Philippines' COVID-19 pandemic response team has developed an online data collection system to provide a faster and more accurate record of coronavirus cases from different local government units. Let's find out more from the team's co-lead, Dr. Teodoro Herbosa. Good morning, Doctor, and thank you very much for joining us again.
Hi, good morning, Christian, and thank you for having me.
Okay, talk to us about this, this online data collection system developed by your team. How does it work?
Okay, the UP COVID-19 Pandemic Response Team is a multidisciplinary team of professors and researchers in different colleges of the University of the Philippines and different campuses. There are mathematicians, math modelers, and from the very start, since March, we've actually developed what is called a dashboard. A dashboard is like a convergence or conglomeration of all the data that is officially published by different agencies like the Department of Health and other agencies, the DILG. So we put it up together and we put other features in that particular dashboard. There's a map where you can see the cases of COVID-19 reported by the DOH. There is an epidemic curve. And most recently, what we've added is what is called the quick count. The quick count is allows local government units, provinces, and even cities, big cities, to actually directly report their cases of COVID-19, probable suspects, etc., into this dashboard. And automatically, we're able to make what we call epidemic curves or compute their reproductive number or the R of that particular province. So this will greatly help the local chief executives in deciding what to do, whether to do the no quarantine, general community quarantine, or enhanced community quarantine. So this is going to be a tool for the local chief executive. And I'm very happy that the Secretary of the Department of Interior and Local Government, Secretary Anyo, has actually endorsed the ngov.ph for use by our local government units.
Actually, that is a very important piece of news because I'm holding a copy of the memorandum issued by the Secretary of the Interior, and basically the DILG decided to adopt the system developed by your team. Now, how is this different from the dashboard or the online collection system also coming from the Department of Health?
Okay, the Department of Health uses what is called an epidemiologic surveillance. When you do epidemiologic surveillance, many facts are actually validated, verified, they cross-check the sources, etc. So it's actually very accurate, but its fault is that it becomes very slow because what happens is local epidemiologic surveillance units will collect the cases to be reported. They report it to the province, to the region, and the region reports it to the National Epidemiology Bureau. And then by the time we get the data, of course, sometimes it's taken some lag time. The beauty of this particular dashboard is that it is real time. So the moment today, for example, if someone reports what the cases they found yesterday there, it's immediately going to be on the dashboard and we won't be able to manipulate it or change it. Only the one that reported it can be able to change it.
But how do you validate the information or data reported to you coming from the
validation LGU? Has to be the local government unit. So if their reports are accurate, what we will return to them as analyzed data is also going to be accurate. Okay. But if you put in a double reporting or inaccurate reporting, of course, the projections and the models might also be not valid. So the responsibility is now passed on to the one reporting the data.
Now, how will you reconcile possible conflicting data or differences with those coming from the DOH as reported?
Of course, the official data will still be the Department of Health data. Ours is just what we call syndromic surveillance. So that's the difference. In syndromic surveillance, what we emergency disaster people do is actually try to look at the syndrome, but not actually the disease. So you may have a higher number reported in the local government units. That's actually true because not all become confirmed eventually. Mm-hmm. So that's where the lag time difference comes, the lag time in our reporting system of confirmed cases. In epidemiologic surveillance, you actually have to report confirmed cases. In syndromic surveillance, you only report people having the syndrome, the set of symptoms, the cough, the fever, and then you'll be able to track the number of cases with the syndrome in a particular locality.
So this way,
when you detect a syndrome, you can go to that locality and start testing. And when you test, that's when you find the cases that you need to isolate. So it becomes a step faster than the epidemiologic surveillance.
But basically, how slow is the DOH count here compared to the system that you have put in place?
It varies depending on, there was a time we were waiting for reports and it takes about 2 or 3 days because I think the reporting system goes through that number of days. So the encoding, I think. Mm. I think the reporting system of DOH is that, I think it's emailed, there is a matrix that's emailed, and then in the central office, they actually encode it. So I think they closed down the system for about 2 days, a few weeks ago. I think that was because they already had 10,000 backlog cases to actually encode. So it becomes very slow. Mm-hmm. So we use the power of technology by being able to report online. So the report is immediately submitted online and it's immediately there at the dashboard mm-hmm. for analysis.
Logically, perhaps sometime in the future, are we looking into the possibility that your dashboard would report more cases than are reported by the DOH? Because certain differences might tend to confuse the public and they might tend to misunderstand. How come the DOH report only has this much number of confirmed cases, but in the UP dashboard, we already have this much cases?
Well, that can be reconciled. Actually, what will happen is you can look at the raw data. Eventually, you can look at the raw data. You will have the names, you will have the specific people, and you will see where the discrepancies are. So you will know whether you are over a certain number or some are not reported and why they were not reported. So basically, what will happen next is that as we ramp up testing, each of the local government units will now have their own test centers. So they may be getting their confirmation test faster before it's submitted to RIPM. So this will be real time. Mm-hmm. The other process is that as they develop sub-national laboratories to do confirmatory tests, the PCR test, what will happen is they will be actually reporting that to RITM also. And RITM is linked with the laboratory information system to the Epidemiology Bureau of the DOH. So there shouldn't be any difference. Eventually, it should be almost the same. It's like a COMELEC quick count, you know?
Yeah.
There is the people, what's called the NAMFREL, doing the quick count of the votes, which is the same electronic votes that are being counted, and then there's the official COMELEC vote. So basically, we'll like the NAMFREL. The UP dashboard will be like a NAMFREL doing a quick count, but getting the reports directly from the LGUs.
And also, this is your way of cutting the red tape, which leads to a lag time, as you mentioned earlier, no?
Correct. It's called real-time reporting. It's syndromic. It's real time. It allows a local chief executive to decide mm-hmm. whether to lock down a sitio, a barangay, or his the response. Because if you use the current reporting epidemiologic survey, there's a lag time. The reports we're seeing are actually a week ago. Mm-hmm. The reports of a week ago that we're actually finding. And by that time, the virus has already spread. So if you want to contain and control this virus, reporting has to be real time. And response has to be immediate. I mean, if we need to get those people that have the symptoms, we need to test them immediately, make sure that the test is available for them so that we can isolate them and prevent transmission.
I understand, based on the system put in place by your team and also as adopted by the DILG, it's the city or municipal disaster risk reduction management officers who would do the reporting directly to your dashboard. But do they have to wait for confirmatory tests before they report certain cases, or just the symptoms would suffice?
Well, the confirmatory tests, they have to wait. If they don't have a laboratory in their area, they'll have to wait for the report of the confirmatory test, whether it's done in RITM or all the other PCR laboratories that are accredited. I think we have 19 already. Hmm. So that one, they will have to wait for that report. So in that case, the confirmed cases will be faster probably in the DOH counts. But once they identify as probable or suspect cases in their locality, sometimes they report higher. We saw this problem when we were when in the initial phase of the dashboard, many LGUs would call us and tell us that our reported number of PUIs in their particular locality was low and was wrong. So we were trying to figure out what the problem was. So we decided to put up this quick count wherein they could report immediately what they say is their true number.
And basically, this would guide their decision-making later on. Now,
so yes, we will return analyzed data back to them, whether they're already peaking, whether they're still in the upslope, and whether they're going below the R of 1, which is really the time you're flattening the curve.
Now, I was looking at the system that you put in place. It's very important. It's an essential tool at this time when the Philippines is still battling this this COVID-19 pandemic. Shouldn't the government have somehow adopted this much earlier? Because we're now at the tail end of this community quarantine. Of course, the cases are still being reported, but di ba dapat mas maaga tong ganito? That they adopted
well,
the system.
Christian, we're also government. The University of the Philippines is the national
government.
But I mean
the national government.
I think the NCOV tracker tries to do this, but we try to improve it. What the academe has done is try to make it as real time as possible. And luckily, our team, the UP Resilience Institute, has had experience with this, with earthquakes and with typhoons as their reporting system of the hazards and the people affected. So they're using this particular background in disaster to be able to use this for this epidemic.
Okay. Now, so far, what do the numbers tell us? Are we nearing that peak or are we still far away from that?
For Metro Manila, it seems we're nearing the peak. I think it will be mid-May or late May that we will actually peak and start to go down in terms of numbers. Even as you report the cases, I think as of yesterday or the past few days, it's always the daily new cases are always below 200, right? So that has been the steady number. So I think the numbers are plateauing based on new cases. The confirmed cases may increase because of the number of testing centers. So that's not very reliable, but I'm more relying on the new cases reported.
Mm-hmm. But are we testing enough people to give us a clearer picture of the infection?
Unfortunately, Christian, that's the other thing the statisticians are saying. We can't give the correct predictions because our testing is too low. We are still at about 2,500 tests per day. We started with about 1,000 tests a day. I think even earlier we had about 600 tests per day, but they were able to increase the number of test centers. But the PCR test is really very, very complex. Very complex. You've seen LGUs that were denied even if they had all the elements in the laboratory, they were denied, and the location had to be changed. And several centers have bought PCRs, have the capacity to do it, but are still in a queue. They're still in a line to get the accreditation needed by by that particular laboratories. And we have areas in the Philippines which are totally have no reporting center. So we were talking yesterday with the people from Region 8. They have to send their samples to Cebu across the water to Cebu before the confirmatory test will be returned to them. And that takes time. So these are the things we have to look at, the distribution of our testing centers. There are some local chief executives now trying to ramp it up by using the rapid antibody test kits, but the rapid antibody test kit is not as reliable as the confirmatory test or the PCR test. So you'll end up doing two. You'll end up doing the rapid antibody test to find some antibody levels, and then still refer them to the RITM or the other testing center in your area for a confirmatory test, which is the official
confirmatory test. And I think the goal of the DOH is to test 8,000, to conduct 8,000 tests daily by the end of April. We're not sure whether they would be able to hit that target. But what a lot of people also find frustrating here is that they're saying that there was a lag time, or there was a lull in February when there were no new cases being reported in the Philippines. yet somehow the government should have set up these testing centers as early as that, because now, obviously, we know that a lot of countries are playing catch up here, but there are certain things that we could have done much earlier. In this case, the establishment of more laboratories, so that more testing would give us a clearer picture of the infection here in the Philippines.
That's true, Christian. No? Some of the things we're reporting now is that RITM recently published the genome sequence of the virus that is transmitting in the community, and we found that it is more similar to the viral component or characteristics of the one that was propagating in Germany. So we have the German kind of COVID-19 or SARS-CoV-2 virus, and that's interesting because the virus may have traveled from China to Germany and from Germany to the Philippines, and because of the number of mutations, they could actually compute backwards when the community transmission happened. And based on their computations, it was really 2 months prior to March 21. So that was in January. So we were already having community transmission when there was like a lull and it was not being picked up and reported.
So this was identified because of the mutation of the virus. You
Correct,
can identify the source.
We have identified the source. I think the other day it was RITM that published the whole genome sequence of the virus that's propagating. The ones that they test, so they did when you do a PCR test, you only test a segment of the virus. It's just like a small fingerprint, you know, so a small sequence, and that is correlated to the whole sequence. So this time they did the genome sequence of the whole genome, the whole RNA sequence of the virus, and they finally found the whole sequence. And that sequence we can compare with viruses from Wuhan, from Korea, from Singapore, from Germany, from Italy, from Spain. So because they also report, the countries report the whole genome sequence that is circulating in their community.
Now, Dr. Ted, if we're still not doing enough testing, how reliable then are projections? Because you may have good systems in place, online data collection systems, such as the platform that your team has come up with. But ultimately, it will depend on the actual tests conducted and officially reported. So how do you make this, how can you come up with a reliable projection if we're not doing enough testing at this point?
Okay, the way to increase it was the procurement of several what we call automation machines. So when you have PCRs, what is done is it's manually tested. It comes out to about 200 to 400 tests a day. But once you do buy the automation, which is like robotics, what will happen is you are able to test 1,200 tests a day per laboratory. So when those analyzers, some of those have already come in, RITM, that's why it's now able to produce about 1,000 or 2,000 tests a day, is that they've automated. So the other places like the UPNIH is also getting its automation machine. And once they do that, from 600, they will also jump up to 1,200. So it will double the current 2,500 a day to about 5,000. And then we get more laboratories. It is the Philippine Red Cross that is really very aggressive. They plan to put up several, I think about 10 laboratories all over their chapters. And they're well-funded because of the private sector funding them. So we will see the private sector together with the Red Cross moving very fast. And the target is like 20,000 tests by mid-May, we will be able to do 20,000 tests a day. And by end of May, the target is something like about 30,000 tests a day for the whole country, so which is already acceptable and very good.
Yeah, and I think in your report, in your briefing paper that your team came up with, there was always that clarification or qualification, the asterisk, no? That this is this projection is still ultimately based on what is officially reported to the DOH, because your assessment was the community quarantine was relatively successful, right?
Correct.
But again, it all depends on the data coming
correct,
from the ground.
Correct. Because if we test more, we may end up finding more positives out there, like what happened in Cebu. In Cebu, they found one person who was residing in a highly densely populated area. So they went to that area, and did random testing of the people. And they found about 80 people positive. So they had to quarantine. They did a lockdown of that particular sitio to prevent it from spreading. I think Manila also did a rapid antibody test for their residents of Sampaloc district. And we're awaiting the results of that. I know they have picked up several what you call antibody positive, which will need to be confirmed by PCR. So again, a combination, in the end, I think a combination of this rapid antibody test and the PCR may be very, very helpful, because the PCR is complex, it takes long, but the rapid antibody is in 15 minutes, you get an antibody count of an antibody status on the COVID-19, which will bring you to either isolation or quarantine or PCR test.
Okay. On that note, thank you very much, Dr. Ted Herbosa, for joining us this morning, sir.
Thank you very much, Christian. Have a good day.
Thank you, sir.